Could we please rise for our national anthem? Thank you, everyone. Hello, my name is Emmanuel Okorafor. I am a volunteer at ACCH Digital Team Member, and I also volunteer in multiple NGOs. I'm an entrepreneur, and I am also prepping to write my LSATs to enter law school. I'll be your host for today's event. With that being said, I'll be passing it on to Mr. Abi Salami, who is a focused individual that has a great passion for continuous success. A director with ACCH, a project management professional, and an independent mortgage broker that offers exceptional service and knowledge of the industry. His love for community building coincides with ACCH's vision of a sense of community and common purpose in enabling environments. And he'll be reading the land acknowledgement. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming. Can I have the slides up, please, Lady Abba?
Yes, up.
It's not showing.
No.
Sorry about that. The land acknowledgement. Halting, as we know it today, is rich in history and modern tradition. It's gone. So sorry about that. Are we good now?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Sorry about that, everybody. Halting, as we know it today, is rich in history and modern tradition of many First Nations and the Métis, from the Anishinaabe to the Attawadaron, the Haudenosaunee, and the Métis. These lands surrounding the Great Lakes are steeped in Indigenous history. As we gather today on these treaty lands, on these three lands, we have the responsibility to honor and respect the four directions: lands, water, plants, animals, ancestors that walk before us, and all the wonderful elements of creation that exist. We would like to acknowledge and thank the Mississauga of the Credit First Nation for sharing their traditional territory with us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, I'll be passing it on to our president, Ms. Adejisola Atiba, also known as Lady Abba. She is an SNR manager with RBC. She is a subject manager expert in retail banking and financial planning. She is the president of ACCH and a community volunteer with various NGOs. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Adejisola Atiba, who will be giving us the welcome address, introduction of ACCH, and ACCH's strategic plan for the year. Over to you, madam.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel Okorafo. Really appreciate all your support. So I welcome everybody. Thank you so much for joining. It's a pleasure to see all the friendly and lovely faces. I want to start by saying that we should please try as much as possible to take care of ourselves, our families, and our neighbors to ensure that we reduce the impact, the negative impact of COVID in our lives. And so my name is Adejisola Atiba, like Emmanuel said, and I just love to serve the community. That is my passion. I tell people that banking is my profession, but community is my passion. So today, I would like to educate some of us about what ACCH is all about. So our focus is to advocate, build, empower, and strengthen our African Caribbean community. Why do we need to empower community? We know that, a lot of things are going on right now, especially BIPOC. We know that when we are lumped together, even though we stand out, yet we will remain unseen and unheard. But the onus is on you and I to make sure that we're seen, that we're heard. And so how can we do that? It's by participating, it's by educating, it's by ensuring that people around us are actually aware of who we are and what we stand for. It's about you and I being involved in the system. If a group of people are together and they're making rules and policies that affect the whole nation and we're not part of it, believe you me, they would not think about us if we're not on the table. So ACCH is all about advocacy. ACCH is all about empowerment. ACCH is all about lifting everybody in the African Caribbean community of the region of Alton Hub. So some of the things that we focus on, like I said, is advocacy for meaningful change. So ACCH actually did the first Black History Month in 2019 in the city of Milton. And in 2020, we're proud to say we were able to do it in all the region of Alton. And so what does that mean? We're educating them about who we are. We're telling them that we can no longer be, just brushed to the side. And by us doing this, we're also supporting our children and even generations unborn. So by doing that, we're supporting an inclusive community. We want to speak up. We need to speak up. We need them to hear us and include us in plans that would actually impact our lives. We're focused on building and strengthening our African Caribbean community. I always believe that education is power. Information is important. When we have the right information, we make informed decisions. And when we work with our policymakers, believe you me, things change for better. We also believe in cultural education. And so today you'll be hearing from somebody from St. Lucia that will educate us about what St. Lucia is all about. We know that in Africa, we have 54 countries. In the Caribbean, we have 15. So how would we appreciate ourselves better if we don't know anything about ourselves? If you have not watched our last Let's Talk Virtual series, please go and look at it because we talked about Rwanda. You want to learn a little bit more about Rwanda. And today we're actually going to be talking about St. Lucia, one of the Caribbean countries. I am waiting. I can't wait enough. I'm so excited to learn a little bit about St. Lucia. And hopefully when COVID just does go away, we will be able to travel a little bit more. During the Black History Month, we heard a lot from parents about what their children are going through. We heard people say that little girls call little girls that has beautifully exotic skin like ours, that their skin look like poo. But we know our skin does not look like poo. I mean, if they have issues with our skin, that is their problem. But what can we do? We can educate them. And that's why ACCH is already working with the school system, both the Catholic board and the public board, to do something to ensure that our children feel valued, to ensure our children are seen and heard, and they can actually support and be proud of their heritage. So we have a lot of things going on. And one of the ways that we educate is the Let's Talk Virtual Series. Our Let's Talk Virtual Series will bring a lot of people in, whether they're community leaders, whether they're elected officials, to come and talk to us. Please check out our YouTube channel so that you can learn more about the ones that we've done. And on that note, I'm just going to say thank you again and welcome. And thank you so much for joining us. Today is going to be packed with a lot of, you know, professionals educating, supporting us, and making sure that we're able to use those information to better each and every one of us. Please tell the story of ACCH within your community. Thank you again, and I hope you enjoy the event. I'll hand it over to Emmanuel. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. President. With that, we'll be moving on to our first topic, that of culture talk. Why culture talk? Within Africa, there are 54 countries and the Caribbean 13. Within the African Caribbean community, there is a plethora of information available within each of our countries. But for us to be able to attain this wealth of information, we need to be able to learn about one another. And with that, we need speakers from each country who can open the door and shed a light, giving us a high-level overview of the culture, the people, tradition, innovations made, and even the proverbs passed. Our last culture talk, as Ms. President said, was on Rwanda, which you can watch on our YouTube channel. The information of our socials is within the chat. This event will mark our second culture talk, and it will be led by our first speaker of today, Mr. Romeo Mitchell, who was born in St. Lucia. Although a Canadian citizen, he says part of him will always be in St. Lucia. He's a member of the Rotary Club of Milton, an honorable member of the E-Club of Uganda. He is the current president of the Milton Rotary and has served in other roles such as director of projects and programs, youth service director, and a club president in 2017-18. He also volunteers on the district environment community. His classification is project management, and he will be speaking to us on the country of St. Lucia. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Romeo Mitchell. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel, for that introduction. It came out better than I thought, you know, like I'm always being placed on some stage occasionally, and I reflect and I say, wait a minute, is that me? No, that's not really me. But by the way, folks, I just want to let you know that I am not coming to you from St. Lucia. Even if the picture gives you that impression, I would love to have been there and present to you from there, at least just for this moment. But unfortunately, all of the restrictions, you know, so I will still bring a piece of St. Lucia to you over the next 20 minutes, etc. So, by the way, this is not coconut water. This is tap water. If I was in St. Lucia, I would be saying, this is coconut water. So, hey, that just tells you. So I'm going to share my presentation. Let me get to it. And you will tell me, someone will tell me whether it's visible. Is it visible?
Yes.
Okay. And is it visible in presentation mode?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So, as you can see, the backdrop is the beach, right? The beach is an extremely common place in St. Lucia. In fact, where I grew up, I was about 5 minutes away from the beach. And when it came to weekends and school breaks and so on, I can guarantee you 90% of the time you would find me on the beach, and I would be riding waves, etc. So what I'm going to talk about, I'm going to take you through five questions that is on your mind, right? The first one is, where is St. Lucia in the world? a lot of people, you know, I meet lots of people and they say to me, oh, so where are you from? I said, originally from St. Lucia. And the next question is, so where is that? Right? So I just want to set the record straight that the only St. Lucia, the real St. Lucia where it is, I believe there is a St. Lucia in the US and a few other places, but believe me, it's not the same. The other thing I'm going to talk about is the history. The history of St. Lucia, who the people are, what has influenced its culture, and about the economy and politics. So I'll just touch on a few of those. As you can see, the pictures that I'm sharing right now, it's a picture of an older view or a partial view of part of the capital, part of the capital. And the picture below is the southern town that's also popular. You see two mountains. That's the one thing that's popular about St. Lucia, the national flag, as well as the coat of arms. And by the way, the coat of arms, it's about the people, the land, the people, and the light. So that gives you an idea of how St. Lucians think. So I'll just go straight into where is St. Lucia in the world? Well, if you look at the top right-hand corner of your screen, I guess you can't see St. Lucia. In fact, the dot that's circling whatever that other dot's supposed to be, that other dot's supposed to be St. Lucia. So I blew it up a bit more so that you can see it, the map just below that. But yet still, you can't see it. So that is the biggest challenge that St. Lucians have, explaining to people where St. Lucia is, because they would go to a map which fits on their computer screen of the world and they can't find it, right? But it's there. And you can see on one side is a touristic view, what St. Lucia does to try to attract tourists to the island. And the other side shows the topography and so on. St. Lucia is hilly, it has a central core, etc. So it's an island, right, in the West Indies, bordered by the Caribbean Sea and the Atlantic Ocean. On one side, you have the Caribbean Sea. On the other side, you have the Atlantic Ocean. It's part of what's called the Lesser Antilles. And by the way, there are over 700 islands in the Caribbean. But if we have to talk about significant islands, it's probably somewhere in the region about 20 or so. Location, it's north of St. Vincent. So if you know, heard of St. Vincent, just recently St. Vincent has been in the news regarding the volcano. St. Lucia is 25 miles north of St. Vincent, and it is northwest of Barbados. Everyone has heard of Barbados. Barbados technically is smaller than St. Lucia, but it has a population which is almost twice the size. And St. Lucia is south of Martinique. Martinique is a French territory. It's like a department of France, and it's considered part of the European Economic Community. The area of the land in St. Lucia is about 238 square miles or 617 square kilometers. And the population is about 180,000. And you're probably saying, wow, 180,000, that's about the population in the village that I grew up in Uganda or in Nigeria or in etc. And yeah, absolutely. The population is what it is, right? The capital is Castries. And when you first visit St. Lucia, that's one of the places that you would probably see first. They would take you from the international airport to the capital, et cetera. Or if you come in on a cruise, you would be coming into the capital in the Deepwater Harbor. So what about the history? Well, you can see on the top right-hand corner, there is a funny looking map, right? That was the interpretation in the, I guess, 1700s, 1600s, what the island shape was. Okay, so that tells you a little bit about the mapping capabilities then and so on. And that was part of the reason why Christopher Columbus lost his way, right? And found himself in the Caribbean. He was actually on his way to India, and he found himself in the Caribbean, thought he was in India because he saw certain folks. The folks that he came across were the, Arawaks, the original settlers within the Caribbean, or within St. Lucia in particular, were called Arawaks Indians. And in about 1800 AD, another tribe, the Caribs, continued to chase the Arawaks north. So in St. Lucia and some of the other islands, you will find Carib reserves. For example, in Dominica, there's a Carib reserve, but you will also find descendants of Arawaks and so on. What happened? The Europeans came over, and they, as usual, they sort of wiped out a lot of the culture, either through illnesses that they brought or through, territorial claims, etc. But it's rather interesting because if you can see, the first Europeans to settle in the island, right, were the French. And they actually signed a treaty with the natives, with the Caribs, in 1660. So the natives had an agreement with the French, and they were living fine with the French. As a matter of fact, in St. Lucia, we speak a broken French Creole, and I'll talk more about that later. The English took control from 1663 to 1667. And there was a constant battle between the English and French over St. Lucia. St. Lucia changed hands 14 times. It was 7 times British, 7 times French, and it eventually fell to the British when the British took control in 1814. So that gives you an idea that it's not too long ago that St. Lucia had a strong French influence. In fact, the land tenure system is still on the French system, whereas other laws are influenced by other British laws. St. Lucia is also known as the Helen of the West, after the Helen of Troy, because they found it, the Europeans found it so beautiful that they compared it with the beauty of the Helen of Troy. It's fascinating, but I had no idea that the Helen of Troy had physical attributes like St. Lucia. But, who are the people? Well, I start off by saying St. Lucians are fun, loving, happy, go-lucky people. And if you look at the pictures on your screen, you can see the kids. They're all smiling. I can guarantee you, if you appear or land in St. Lucia today and you look at a kid and you smile, the kid will smile back, right? St. Lucians tend to trust first. St. Lucians are very trusting people. But if you lose that trust, you have lost it forever. So that's the way St. Lucia is. They're very trusting, very open, but once you lose that trust, it may take generations to get it back, etc. St. Lucians, given the opportunity to excel, they do wonders. As an example, the picture to your right, the gentleman with the smile and wearing the glasses, he is a Nobel Prize laureate for economics. The one below, with his fist against his face, he's a Nobel Prize laureate for literature. St. Lucia has the highest number of Nobel Prize laureates per capita in the world, period. And in addition to that, there are others you will hear about but not realize that they are St. Lucians in different areas, probably within the US, within Canada, etc., that have done, quite a few things, etc. The gentleman with his hand and speaking, he is a well-known cricketer in today's time. And, you mention his name to folks from India, from Pakistan, from the UK, anywhere about cricket, they will tell you about him, etc. Danny is his name. So this is, and you can see, you see green bananas and some that stuff in the middle there. That's actually, I believe it's saltfish or fish that's been dried, right? The folks in the, you can see cannibal costumes, you can see national costs wear by the gentleman that's in the group there. So, and the beach as usual. So what has influenced its culture? St. Lucia's culture has been influenced by Africa, East Indian, French, and English. However, it is funny enough, it's the African culture that has the deepest influence between the African culture and the French culture. It has the deepest. We, you know, sometimes I reflect on, say, somewhere like Côte d'Ivoire, etc. And I can see lots of similarities in terms of Côte d'Ivoire. The difference is, you know, St. Lucians, as you can see, the lady's having fun, she's smiling. They're just happy, go lucky people. The picture above represents events that's held in St. Lucia. In fact, this is the jazz festival, one of the biggest annual festivals in St. Lucia. And jazz musicians come from all over the world to perform in that festival, etc. And it's held in different locations around the island, and so on. But in addition to that, there are other things that happened in St. Lucia. There is a slight error there. It says on August 30, and you know, I'll probably delete that. But really, this was meant to tell you different festivals. In fact, I will just escape from this, delete it, so it doesn't cause further confusion. And this is how it should be. How about that? Okay. St. Lucia's cultural festivals include the La Rose. And if you experience the La Rose festival, you will see similarities to the African culture. If you experience the La Marguerite festival, you will see similarities as well, right? The jazz festival has a lot to do with, you know, music. St. Lucians love music, love sports, love to dance, and the carnival, etc. All of those things are part of the culture itself. So what about the economy and politics in terms of St. Lucia? Well, categorized as a small developing state, right? The service sector makes up about 82% of the gross domestic product. And when I talk about the service sector, I'm not just talking about tourism. I'm talking about things that support tourism. I'm talking about other service sectors like telecommunication, et cetera, et cetera. So that makes up 82%. But there are other industries, agriculture, and there are other small industries. Think of St. Lucia as a micro economy similar to any other developing economy with all of the attributes, etc. So you can see there are lots of things to do in St. Lucia. When folks come to St. Lucia, there's so many things that you can't even express it in one picture. And this is part of the picture below, represents the Deepwater Harbor. And as you can see, there are four large tourist vessels in the harbor. Those are huge vessels, and they come in, you know, if it wasn't for COVID, it would be almost on a daily or every other day, you have those ships coming in and port in, you know, coming into port for the day, etc. In addition to other shipping that takes place within that community. St. Lucia is a member of the Commonwealth, and it's also a member of the what's called the CARICOM, which is a Caribbean community. Now, there is a group of islands that St. Lucia has amalgamated with called the OECS, the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States. There are nine islands within the OECS, and those nine islands are viewed from an economic and from a political perspective as a unit. When I say political, in that someone who resides in St. Lucia can literally go to Dominica or St. Vincent or Grenada or Antigua, right, and just simply settle and live. They don't need to produce visa or anything like that. They can just simply go with either an ID card from St. Lucia or if they have their passport, etc., and there are no questions asked. You're a citizen of the OECS. You're a citizen of St. Lucia. You're a citizen of the OECS. And that's what has evolved in terms of breaking down borders and barriers, etc. So this is the economy. Now, I know that I didn't have a lot of time, but you know this guy in the picture that says, thank you, Romeo? This could have been me, right? In fact, I wish it was me saying thank you to you, right? This is typical of how St. Lucians are, right? We're welcoming with open arms. We say thank you, you know, we tell you come again, etc. And there isn't one person that visited St. Lucia that told me that they would not go back and they would tell me about their experience. So you can see some of those cluster of pictures here. This is in the south of the island. This is in the north of the island. That is Sandals, actually, the Sandals Hotel, right? And by the way, there are no private beaches, right? So you have St. Lucians going to the beach along with the tourists, and it doesn't really matter. Right. This is a location called the Diamonds Falls in the southern part of the island. You know, you go and have a really nice bath there. You can see some of the stuff from the market, and some of those products, they're very familiar. Right. We know soursop. You may call it a different name. Right. But, you know, we know those fruits, and you can see it is very, the environment is very tropical. And then there is the marine life as well. Fantastic marine life. As a matter of fact, a lot of folks, tourists come to go to St. Lucia to do scuba diving. All right. So this is it. I don't know whether I exceeded my 20 minutes. If I did, please let me know. Otherwise, Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Romeo, for that. And no, you're perfectly fine within time. But regarding Q&A, please, please, please save your questions. You can write them in the chat, and they will be and will be discussed later down the line once all our speakers have presented. So I just wanted to touch on a few things you talked about. You talked about the history and how the island changed hands within because of the wars that happened. That was pretty interesting. I don't think there's another nation that just within that course of time, so many things happened that people will probably not even know what's going on, that who are they serving, or who's in the charge as well, right? As well as the fact that two Nobel Peace Prize, making them like the highest per capita in the world, both for very educational purposes as well. And also touch on the influences, the religion, the food, and one of my favorites is the tourist attractions, which I cannot wait to go see once I am financially sound. So thank you so much for that wonderful discussion.
Yeah, and there was one thing I did not mention, which I should have. St. Lucia is probably about 90% of African descent. Okay. And that is as a consequence of the slave trade, etc. But it became very difficult to control the Africans that were in St. Lucia, as you can see from the mountainous aspects and so on. So it was one of those situations where the French didn't care because they had an agreement and that was it, but the British were slightly different. But what the locals did, they stuck with the Creole. So the British never understood what they were saying because the British hate the French anyway. So, you know, and it was a happy-go-lucky situation. So
thank you.
Yeah.
So I hope everyone learned something. And if you have questions, please put them in the chat. Okay, so we'll be moving on to our next speaker, Ms. Idosa Adams Idode, who is an uncompromising advocate with a strong focus and practice in family and immigration law for more than a decade. She is an advocate voice on access to justice issues and has a strong passion for community empowerment and volunteerism. She represents families who are dealing with family violence and child protection service matters. She sits on several boards and volunteers for ACCH. She's a wife and a mother of three teenage boys who love basketball. She is currently in the process of completing her LLM in dispute resolution at Osgoode Law School at York University. She'll be speaking to us on the changes in family law. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Idose Adams Idode. Over to you, madam.
Thank you so much, Emmanuel. Wonderful Romeo on St. Lucia. all we hear about is Jamaica, Jamaica, but you kind of brought in, you know, the real deal, the real McCoy, as they say. And I think all the islands are beautiful. They're all beautiful. So let's move away from a happy vacation in St. Lucia. And let's talk, This is why we're here today. Let's talk about family violence. And I will, before I start my slide, we all know that there's an African adage that says that where two elephant fights, the grass suffers, right? And the real casualties in family violence are the children. And it's important that we all, as a community, talk about it, because there is obviously a culture of silence, stigma, and shame that comes with that, associated with family violence in our community. So I'm going to be sharing my slides. If you bear with me, let me open it. And it's going to be a short presentation, so not to worry. We're not going to be here for too long. One moment, please. Okay, and so we want to thank ACCH for allowing us to, you know, really come together as a community to talk about family violence, because family violence affects all of us. And it is also important for us to know that in my introduction, I want everybody to know that the goal of today's presentation is not to tell you what the process is to end your relationship or to leave your relationship. The goal of today's presentation is to give you information of the changes in the meaning of the language that we often hear about. Today's goal is also to also give you from different lenses, from a mental health perspective, the effects of family violence on the children, if they're joining in the relationship. And of course, to provide resources in our community. Access to justice is real justice when the community comes together, when all of us in our different professions sit down together on a round table to really talk about the issues that affect us. And that's when real access to justice happens. So the changes in the law are intended to help the parents, judges, and others make safe and appropriate arrangements where there has been family violence. And that's part of what we're going to be talking about today. But we do understand, and I'm hoping that I have an audience of professionals here, that the social reality of domestic violence is that it impacts all of us. Our culture obviously plays a central role in family matters and family violence. But most importantly, I believe that there's no doubt that children benefit more from having more than one person responsible for making decisions about them. But as a caveat to that, where there's a situation of violence or abuse, the above statement of more than one person making decisions together is not necessarily true. Why? Because the parent who has been the abusive spouse is not often motivated by what is in the best interest of the child. Now, what is in the best interest of a child will be explained in my further slide, but that is really the legal paradigm that family law is centered about when it comes to responsibilities of parents and their role in the relationship. Before I move on, I want to also just highlight that this is a public forum. As a lawyer, I cannot give legal advice, and I would kindly ask everyone to share personal or confidential information. The whole idea of this virtual series is that we need to start to talk about this serious and important matter, which is family violence, because it affects all of us. And it's important that we start to speak up, because when we speak up, we don't know who else we're helping in terms of their experience in dealing with family violence. And so why do we need to speak up? There is a data that I wanted to share with everyone here today. And this is actually a report from the Catholic Cross Cultural Services in Mississauga. What do we know about COVID-19 and family law issues? obviously, the unprecedented times that we live in has accelerated stress on individuals and families, leading to conflicts. There is an alarming escalation of domestic violence and mental health issues, substance abuse and drug abuse. There's also, as we all know, economic uncertainty with respect to the COVID and loss of income. Relocation and parenting disputes have been one of the highlights of family law disputes in the court. And so education and medical decision is also another aspect of family dispute in family court, as well as health issues. So if you look at the chart that I have before you, you would see that in 2018 and 2019, the amount of calls that came in through the service provider, the Catholic Cross Culture, were within the range of 90 to about 100, right? So those were the amount of calls for services for dealing with family violence. That is in 2018 and 2019. But what did we see in 2020? There obviously was an increase in the number of calls. And then more, even more alarming is in 2021, which is this year, and this is accurate information that I got directly from the source. In 2021, by April, the numbers blew up. So we're having 145 cases, reported cases, and some repeat clients dealing with domestic and family violence. And so that is why it's so critical. And that's why when I say family violence affects all of us, legally, socially, financially, economically, and health and mentally, it does affect all of us. And that is why it is necessary for us. The data speaks for itself. We have a problem, and we can fix it if we look within ourselves and begin to address and begin to find probable solutions to it. And so I wanted to bring up a case study. And this case study is actually a real life family law case that I was involved with. The names of the parties in this case are not real, but the facts are very real. And the case is as follows. Hello, my name is Michelle. I am 30 years old. I met Chris while we were both teenagers. Chris is 32 years old. We lived together for 15 years before our separation. And we have three children, ages 12, 10, and 7. I endured physical, mental, emotional, and verbal abuse to the extent that I finally left for a shelter after one occasion of severe beating and humiliation in front of the three children in February 2002. And all this happened, like I said, this is not a fictional story. It's actually a real life case that I was involved with. So due to Chris' vindictive, controlling, and domineering abuse over the years, I am still terrified of any form of contact with him and feel very unsafe being alone with him. On July 19, 2007, while Chris was exercising his access at the park by my mother's house, he suddenly began making advances towards me and stated in front of the children that I should move back with him so that we can be happy. He also stated that it would help clear my name as he has heard rumors of me sleeping around. I refuse, stating that I am happy with my life now and feel safe for the past 5 years without him. Chris became immediately angry and abusive, shouting and calling me obscene names while the children watched. I was extremely uncomfortable and terrified, and the visit ended abruptly. This is Michelle's own words. And why this case was highlighted is because in 2002, when this incident occurred, the law had not changed its language. The law had not put a pin to the societal ramifications of domestic violence. And where I highlighted in the story, when after one occasion, after a severe beating, I actually asked Michelle, not her real name again, and I said to her, what was the turning point for you? And then she responded by saying why she left with respect to this severe beating that happened on this specific date in February 2002 was she was actually in the shower and Chris grabbed her out of the shower and beat her in front of her children. And she said to herself, that was her turning point. And so when I asked her, what was your plan for parenting time, which was a term that we used to call access. So if you hopefully relate to this story is critical because over the next few slides, you're going to see how the language was coincide, and you're going to see how the language is so important in the legislation that has now changed. And so Michelle said to me when I asked her what would be her plan for Chris to see the children, she said, I've always been reasonable and supportive in fostering a positive relationship between Chris and the children. I understand that the children love their father and they have a right to him in their lives and vice versa. Once again, the principle here is that this is a lady who was going through abuse. This is a lady who got legal representation. And this is a lady who had to deal with the issue based on the language that was used at that time, which is access and custody. But I just wanted everyone to know that even though the language has changed with respect to Bill 207, the overarching factor for every court and every lawyer or every legal practitioner is that what is in the best interest of the child. And that's really the focus of this Let's Talk series. What's in the best interest of the child means what interests that matters to us as a community, that matters to the judicial system, is the child's interest. And that is the lenses which the court would always determine and which the court will always make decisions with respect to the rights of the children. And so it boils down to definitions again. And definitions I know are very important because on September 2019, I apologize, the Attorney General of Ontario introduced what we call a Bill 207. And the bill was actually termed Moving Ontario Family Forward Act. The bill was long anticipated because the federal government had passed a similar legislation with the Divorce Act of Canada. Now, we do have two legislations that I'm going to briefly talk about. One is the Divorce Act of Canada, which obviously relates to persons who are married. And then the provincial legislation, which is the Bill 207, which is the Children's Law Reform Act, which we're also going to be discussing. So the definition of family violence came into effect with Bill 207, which is the Children's Law Reform Act. And Section 18 of the Act defines family violence means any conduct by a family member towards another family member that is violent or threatening that constitutes a pattern of coercive and controlling behavior or that causes the other family member to fear for their own safety or for that of another person. And in the case of a child, this includes direct or indirect exposure to that conduct. So the essence of this definition was to give a much easier and faster and more affordable means for people and family to resolve family matters. But most importantly, it was relevant to the public interest. The public interest includes you and I, to ensure that children of married individuals and children of unmarried individuals are treated the same under both the federal and the provincial legislation. So when we talk about the reality or the social impact of family violence, we can understand that these definitions that are in place will help to foster consistency in the application of the legislation, whether you're going to be applying a federal legislation that deals with family violence or you're going to be applying a provincial legislation that deals with family violence. So why is it important to understand the definition of family violence? And once again, with respect to the bill that was passed, We understand that women in Ontario continue to experience greater family violence abuse. This is information from experts and victims of domestic violence abuse. And it is also important for us to understand that when we put a definition to a word, it helps us to evaluate the standard by which we would apply to that word. So under the Children's Law Reform Act, again, for the purpose of defining family, for the purpose of definition of family violence, which we had just defined under subsection one, the conduct need not constitute a criminal conduct. So when we talk about conduct of a person, right, when we talk about what conduct that that we describe as family violence, the act further explains and gives more detailed examples of that conduct. One of that conduct is physical abuse. Physical abuse, we have examples of it. It includes hitting, pushing, pinching. All of this is physical abuse. Any forced confinement is physical abuse. We do know that this type of physical abuse also are examples of assaults under the Criminal Code of Canada. But as a caveat, when someone is protecting yourself from abuse in a family violence situation, that could not necessarily be an assault. Now, we also want to look at other examples of family violence that is described by the new legislation. Before March 1st, 2020, sorry, 21, this definition was not in the legislation. So it's important for us to recognize that this definition now has been included in legislation, and examples of the definition has also been very highlighted as well. So when we look at other types of family violence, we are going to be looking at sexual abuse, threats to kill or cause bodily harm. Other examples could include harassment, which is like calling or emailing or texting someone frequently, or following somebody or watching them in their workplace, or even monitoring them through the apps. Right now, we're all situated at home. So if you're watching someone through the apps, and that conduct constitutes a safety issue for the person, that could be family violence as well. Failing to provide necessities of life, which would include obviously food, or not letting somebody get medical care when they need to take or when they need it, that constitutes family violence. Psychological abuse, which is very huge, especially during COVID, includes yelling, criticizing, insulting somebody, controlling their time, their actions, like sort of controlling what they would wear, not letting them have friends in the community or share pictures with other their friends or who they want to share it, or even not allowing someone practice their religion or their culture. It is family violence according to the definition, under the Act. And as well, you have financial abuse, threats to kill or harm an animal or property. All of this is family violence. So we are taking this into consideration because we do know that these changes obviously allow judges and parents and social workers, as well as mental health experts, to provide probable support and services to families who are experiencing this. So the goal of the Act, which is Bill 207, that came into that was passed recently, the goal was to actually modernize the language that we use. It was also to simplify the different routes that appeal routes in the court, and improve the existing online child support services. That was one of the primary goals of Bill 207, Moving Ontario Family Forward Act. So in discussing family violence, I thought that the words that we use interchangeably, domestic violence and family violence, I had a question I wanted everyone to show of hands. Is domestic violence the same as family violence? Are they the same? Can we have a show of hands? Yes or no? You want to type that on the charts? Are they the same? They are actually the same thing. Those, even though the word family violence has been coined into the legislation, domestic violence or family violence are the same. They have the same effect. They have the same meaning. So the purpose of aligning the two legislations, which is the Divorce Act and the provincial legislation, which is the Children's Law Reform Act, was for judges needed to consider the impact of family violence on parenting arrangements for children when their parents divorce. This includes the ability, willingness of the person who has committed the violence to care for the child and cooperate with the other parent. I just gave you a case study of Michelle and Chris. From that case study, you can now understand why this legislation is so important for families, for persons working with families dealing with family violence. So with respect to the new Divorce Act, it actually lists the same similar factors as the Children's Law Reform Act. And one of those factors was that judges need to look at when they consider the impact of family. Sorry, the new act also factors that judges need to look at when considering the impact of family violence. They have to consider situations such as the nature, seriousness, and the frequency of the abuse. They also have to consider the risk of harm to the child and whether the person engaging in that abusive conduct has taken any steps to prevent further violence and improve their parenting, such as completing a parenting course. Initially, I gave an introduction that where two elephants fight, the grass is the one that suffers. So you can now see that the federal government, the provincial government, are now taking it more serious to legislate certain conducts that affects and that can cause significant repercussions for our children, our family. And so that is why judges must also consider, this is in making decisions with respect to parenting, judges must also consider any other court matter that is relevant to the safety, the security and well-being of the child. This includes criminal convictions for assaulting a child or other child protection matters, as well as criminal convictions for crimes against another family member. This act is so welcoming because it really identifies and looks at the seriousness and the impact of family violence on women, on children, and on men as well. Why do we have a situation with family violence, and why is it a reason for us to talk about today? We do know that when parents separate, there is a downward mobility, both economically and socially. And so the current Divorce Act uses words such as custody order. Under the current act, what used to be a custody order has now been replaced with parenting order. So the language, like I said before, there is a modernized change in the language. We no longer use the word custody order. We would now use the word parenting order. And the term custody has also been replaced to make a distinction between parenting time and decision-making responsibility. That is why this new legislation is so welcome. And so we would actually be looking at the definitions of parenting time and decision-making because language matters. I repeat, language matters. When we have a language of communication, it creates an understanding and it helps for consistency and it helps to deal with the process so that we can find solutions to the issues that are affecting our communities. Now, when we use the word decision-making response, I actually prefer using that word than custody because in my experience, it is a misnomer that custody is more of a gendered-centered approach with our judicial system. And that's really not true because custody is really about decision-making. It's not about which parent is better than the other parent. Mm-hmm. It's really about decision-making. And so we're going to look at the definitions of parenting time and decision-making in the next slide. So what is decision-making responsibility and parenting time? Under the Children's Law Reform Act again, it defines decision-making to mean responsibility for making significant decisions about the child's well-being. And this includes their health, education, culture, religion, spirituality, and significant extracurricular activity. Parenting time, on the other hand, it means the time a child spends in the care of a parent of a child, whether or not the child is physically with that parent during that time. So this is one of the key components of the definitions that we have now. And then it's important that we can see that the language change with Bill 207 and the new language that we use, I just thought it was important for us to see the difference. And that's why I presented this picture view, this snapshot. So under the old language, which is the Children's Law Reform Act, this is all provincial legislation. There was no definition of family violence under the old language. Under the old language, under equal parenting, we had, it was described as a child, that both parents have equal, entitled to custody and access of a child. But under the new language, you can see on the right-hand corner, right, we have decision-making responsibility. Once again, the term access has changed to parenting time. Very important. And I just talked about the fact that we now have what we call contact order, which means any person other than the parents of a child, this includes grandparents, may apply to a court for a contact order with respect to a child. So it is important that this new language change obviously aligns with what the modernized use of what parents, judges, social workers need to start to identify and also need to also provide services to if and when needed. Once again, COVID has created unprecedented times for everyone. And so for family law practitioners like myself, we have been overwhelmed with cases of family violence. This is something that is happening in our society. This is something that is happening to our neighbors, our friends. And ACCH, the goal is to educate and to advocate. And I feel that our responsibility as parents to educate and to advocate for our children, as well as to talk about these issues. Because when we talk about these issues, we can start to identify and find ways to address it. Family violence impacts our environment, it impacts our economy, and also it impacts our social services that we have. And so I'm going to allow time for questions because I think this is more of an interactive session. And I didn't want it to be like a case study, but I just wanted us to understand that the change in language is significant to our understanding. It's also significant to our application of the terms that we need to start to identify, which is family violence is real. Family violence impacts all of us, and we need to start talking about it. And so finally, I want to also address that while we're talking about it, we need to understand that there are effective legal support and resources that can really help. And if you are in a relationship that family violence exists, or if you know someone experiencing one, you can get help. You can get help from victim services, the community organizations, support groups. You can get help from transitional homes. There's so many resources. There's legal aid. You can talk to your doctor. I'm so happy that we have a mental health expert that will communicate and educate us on the impact of family violence on the child, on separating people, on separating adults, and also to educate us on the psychological effect of that, as well as provide support services. It's one thing to identify a problem or to identify an issue, and it's another thing to know that we have to address it. And one way of addressing this is by having this discussion. So let's talk about it. And I would conclude by saying this. So as African Caribbeans and as Canadians, family violence can happen to all kinds of families. It can happen to newcomers, immigrants, refugees, whatever term you want to call. It can happen to anyone. It can happen to women and men. It can happen to people who have children and people who don't have children. It can happen to professionals, stay-at-home parents, and individuals of all backgrounds, culture, race, or creed. But we should also understand that family violence can happen, also happen at any stage of a relationship. And it is profoundly detrimental with respect to the consequences for the child. More importantly, relationships and the family act as an emotional and economical support system, as well as a forum for intimacy in that regard. It serves as a vital personal interests and may be linked to building a comprehensive sense of personhood. We know that our children are the future, and we know that children are modeled based on what they see and based on their upbringing. And that is why it is superly important that in nurturing our young society, which is our children, that initial environment for the development of their skills, that initial environment needs to give them a sense of well-being, a sense of wellness, a sense of spirituality, so that as they grow to be adults in their lives, they would make better citizens. And so conversely, families often require sacrifices as a priority. Whether you're a parent in interest or shared goals, all of these elements are undeniably important in shaping the character and the future of relationships. So where one's fundamental interest as with respect to the right to raise a child in the community and the right to have family relationships, where all this is at stake, which is what we're seeing now from a legal perspective, they are all at stake. What happens? The principles of fundamental justice is invoked. The principles of the rights of the child and the best interest of the child is invoked. So I'm hoping that through this Let's Talk series, we will start to see and take formidable steps to address family violence in our community. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for that. Just a lot on my mind. Thank you so much for that discussion. Sharing the story, that personal story with your client, as well as also touching on the importance of not only the language used, but what is used to define said language, right? As well as shedding a light on what judges must take into account when coming to the decision in regards to divorce within a family, and how they really try to take into account the child's well-being, not only mentally, but also in the environment that the child is raised. I'm sure there are lots of questions that everyone wants to ask. Even I have one or two questions I want to ask, but I'll be saving that for the end. We'll be moving on to our next speaker, Ms. Abiola Akinremi, who is a founder and CEO of AA Medical Services, a speaker, a mother, a coach, a registered nurse by profession, and who loves to give back to her community. She'll be speaking to us on the importance of mental wellness. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Abiola Akinremi. Over to you, madam. Madam, you're on mute.
Hello. Sorry about that. How is everybody doing? Can you hear me? Yes? Okay. That's great. I just want to introduce myself again, just a little bit of who I am. My name is Abiola, and I am a registered nurse. And I work with the ACT team. I don't know if anyone knows what an ACT team are. Actines are, we work with psychiatrists. It's a mental health organization, and it's in the community. And we work with, the meaning of actin is ACCT, is assertive community treatment team. So we're a group of team, and we work together. There's psychiatrists, there's nurses, there's social workers, the dual diagnosis, there is addiction specialists, and there's occupational therapists. So there's many different groups of healthcare that they come together and we work together as one. And that's the whole idea, in order for us to be able to work and to be able to support the individual that are suffering from mental health. So I am a mental health nurse, registered nurse, and I've been working with this particular organization for a couple of years now. So we just really wanted to talk about, you know, different areas that of mental health. I want to, you know, let everyone know that one of my passion is really is working with individuals that are vulnerable in the society. And you might be wondering, who are vulnerable? There's a lot of people that are vulnerable that don't have a voice, that, you know, their voice is not loud enough for people to hear, and saying that they're going through something difficult in their life. And right now we want to talk about the area of vulnerable people. I would say vulnerable people will be people that are going through divorce, the family, the impact of mental health in the family. So I try actually to, right now, I'm trying to bring up my presentation. It's not coming up. It happened to me once and it's happening to me again. I thought I was all ready. It should be. I pressed the entire screen and nothing comes up. So I'm just going to go further and just not have to show it then. So I have it with me just in case. So I wanted to talk about the impact of family and divorce, what divorce can actually do in the family, and what causes it, and who's affected, how the family as a whole are affected by divorce or separation or trauma in the family. So, and sometimes, you know, you think that, okay, it's only for divorce or separation, but it's actually sometimes there's a lot of trauma in the family and nothing is really being done. And the kids are seeing this, they're watching this, they're seeing how this is affecting the parents, and it's affecting them because they're taking that anger or that feeling, they're taking it out on themselves and thinking that maybe it's because of them, right? So I just wanted to talk about some of this stuff. So the impact of separation of family or violence in the home, it has a lot of impact. One of them is it weakens the parents and the child's relationship. So it does. So when the parents divorce each other, or there's a separation that goes on between, there's another separation that happens between the parents and the children as well. And that's what we need to explore, because sometimes we think that once the divorce is over or the separation is over, so we think that that's it, you know, everybody moves on. But there's a certain type of level of separation that happens between the children and the parents. The primary effect of the divorce is a decline in relationship between the parents and the children. That most likely could happen. It doesn't happen all the time, but it's most likely could happen. Immediately after the divorce, most parents have two sets of problems. One of them is adjust to their own internal psychological conflict or to their own role as a divorced parent. It's hard on the parents, so they have to figure out what's going on. So they're having a lot of mixed feeling. There's a lot of things going on in the home. Another one is stress of the divorce. We all understand that the damage that it causes, the parents, and it causes that relationship to separate. So what are some of the damages? For example, emotional, psychological, physical, pain, the worrying about the future. So they're worrying about the future. What does the future hold for me? What does the future hold for our family, our home? So everyone is worried. The children is worried. The parents are worried. Financially, psychologically, physically, everybody's worried. Another thing is that children of divorced parents sometimes receive less emotional support, resulting in trust issue. So, you know, they're getting they're living with one of the parents, but they're not getting that level of support that they used to have with the other parents. So that level of support is there. There's something there. There's a gap in what they're receiving. Another one is the quality of the parents' relationship declines with the kids. Parents develop anger, sometimes resentment towards the other parent, the other partner. That anger could be reflected towards children. And sometimes we don't know. You know, when we're having a bad day, we come back from work, and then the kids are, you know, they're asking us a question we don't want to answer because we're so tired or we had a bad day. We don't mean to be we don't mean to treat our kids that way or to shout or to be angry. It's just the feeling that we had that day, or we're not having such a great day. But sometimes with divorce too, it happens that way. We don't mean to. It's not intentional, but the kids see that. Everybody sees that in each other, that anger, right? Divorce can lead to a decline in the frequency and quality of parents-child contact and relationship. The children spend less time with the other parent. Decreased emotional closeness, wellness. Sometimes children's relationship with their parents worsen after divorce. So that's very, very disruptive, and it creates distance between the parents and the children. So we want to look at some of the, we just want to look a little bit into the children's mind, how they're thinking. You know, we want to look at the children's view of divorce when they're in it, when they're going through it, or when it happens. Because I think we need to, sometimes it's good to put ourselves in somebody's foot or shoes, they say, in order to kind of see what's going on. Regardless of age, children of divorced parents can deeply resent the strain and difficulty which arise in long-held family celebration, tradition, daily routine, and special times. So when you think about it, you know the holidays that we normally have, all those holidays and celebration and Christmas and Easter and all, whatever, all those special holidays that we have, can you imagine now that it's different? Somebody's missing. Somebody's not there, right? And so instead of enjoying it, they start to resent it. And I have lots of clients. They tell me they hate the holiday. They don't like the holiday. And they tell me this because, you know, when you look at their background, they had a very difficult childhood, an abusive childhood, right? Divorce in the family. And the holiday reminds them of the gathering of family, that unity that no longer is there for them. So it's a very difficult time for children, you know, during the holidays and during the special celebration time, like somebody's birthday. So what are the things? Children weaken ability to handle conflict. We find that some of the things that happen with children that come from divorce or violent or separation family, or I'm just going to mention some of them, some of the things that are they're having difficulty with. One of the things is they find it very difficult to handle conflict. So handling conflict is a big problem. So what they do is that they increase the use. Some people, they have to find a way to cope. How do you find a whole way to cope with your emotion and what you're going through? And one of the ways is some people can use drugs. Some people can use alcohol. Some people can use other coping mechanisms, like other strategies that are negative, which could be harmful to them, because they're looking for a way to cope and they can't find that solution. They can't find a way to cope. So we do find that children and family, when you're going through a difficult time and the problem is not being solved, they look for different ways to cope. And it could be negative or positive. We prefer the positive. And we can talk about the positive later on at the end of this the presentation. So there's also physical health that's involved, and that's the stress. You know, when you feel stressed, it's hard for you to even hear properly. Like you don't hear clearly because you're so stressed out, you know. So stress, right, causes high blood pressure, causes chronic pain, causes so many physical and emotional pain. And when children and family are going through this, what happens is that they start feeling this stress. Everyone is feeling that stress or that anxiety. They get anxiety. You know, they get nervous. They don't know what's going on. Their body is so nervous, and they don't know why it's going on. There's an increased emotional, psychological burden that happens. Their mind is racing. The thought is racing. They're thinking about a whole bunch of different things, things that are real and things that are not really real, right? So their mind is playing games on them. And then, of course, you know, with that, what happens is that that stressfulness starts to build up as time goes on. If they're not getting help, counseling, support, it starts to build up, because when you're not solving a problem, the problem was, it continues to increase. So they start having that feeling, you know. So we want to talk about also the behavior, like damaging behavior, like things that are very, very negative that some children or that experience sometimes is suicidal thoughts. You know, start feeling that they don't have any hope, or they start feeling that they're not needed, or what you know, how can they go further in life when this is happening in their home, and they feel the shame sometimes, the shame that goes along with that, and some kids actually blame themselves and say, is it possible that this is caused by me? Is it because what I did? So that start blaming themselves for what is going on in the family. And this is very important that the parents, both parents, sit the kids down and really talk about what's really going on, so that they understand it's not about them, right? So that they don't blame themselves for what's going on. And then children also start developing diminishing social skills. So it's difficult for them to actually socialize with their friends and just get together and just have a good talk and just... They find it very, very difficult to, you know, they have this fear. They start developing fear with their peer and the fear of rejection from their peer. So the rejection from home is now reflecting from inside, outside of how they feel about themselves outside. So this is really, really key, important thing for everyone to remember today, that what's happening inside, it reflects now outside. And then it starts to build up, and if you don't get help for it, it starts to get worse. So, and we also find that the kids, right, sometimes the kids, there's dropouts, they go through suspension, acting out in school, educational and career achievement sometimes goes down. IA students cannot start getting, you know, C, and you don't know why. The school might not even know why this is happening, right? So some those are the things that you need to look for, or what are the changes that's going on? Let's talk about the psychological behavior too. Psychological behavior, it would be like a variety of psychological outcomes that is associated with parental divorce, like vulnerability in some children. And some children goes the other way, which is great, resiliency. We like that. Resiliency is so important, but not all children can do that. Not all children can be resilient. So that's why we have to monitor our children and get the support that they need. This is the key, getting the support that they need during this time, during this process, during the separation, during the divorce, during the time that this violence is going on, they need help, they need support. And also, some of the psychological behavior, we talked about, you know, they can use drugs related. It could be drug related. And then it's important for the family to try to keep close as possible. Some of the things that we need to look for is, we find that children that come from violent homes or divorce home or separation, are the attitude towards marriage could be a little bit different as well. We find that they find it very difficult with relationship, difficulty to handle commitment. And it's because of what they see at home and the separation that happened between their parents. So they don't know the meaning of marriage. Like, what is it really about? Is it a, so that difficulty to understand what commitment is could be a challenging thing for them. And we talked about the fact that, you know, their achievement and what they're doing. They could be very active before, volunteering, great, you know, great report, you know, very active kids, very healthy kids. And then all of a sudden, you start noticing that they're not as healthy, they're not as social, and they're not going out there, and maybe not even eating well. You notice that they're losing weight, or you notice that they're not, the behaviors change. So those are things that we need to look for, that we know that this child might need, they might need help. So let's, we talked about, now we talked about some of the things that can happen when children are going through this very difficult time. Let's talk about how the family can kind of deal with it, or how they can try to solve some of these problems, because we're looking for solutions on how to help the family. So I'm going to go through some of the solutions. Families are often considered to be a safe place, right? When we go to our families, we go home, we consider it to be safe, right? We're safe, we are ourselves. We don't have to pretend to be anybody else. So it's important that for us to know that it's a family, it's supposed to be a safe place, a refuge, right? So although conflict may happen from time to time, when they are common, so what we need to do is that we, as a family, there should be a family relationship of trust, safety, support. And when it breaks down, that becomes very, very difficult. Children are now looking for, where is that safe haven? Where is that safe place? Where can I go to be safe when this is happening in my family, when I feel that something's happening, that the walls are breaking down? So, you know, that's, so it's important for us to know what family is all about, and the safety of children, and the safety that we, you know, that they see. We come home, we're safe. I know I'm protected, I'm safe at home. So, but when that is taken away from them, it becomes very, very difficult. So another thing is, I'm going to give you a few tips on solving some of these conflicts. So we should try to stay from the blaming, you know, blaming each other, because that's one of the things, first thing that happens when divorce is happening and there's a conflict in the family, is that we're blaming each other and pointing fingers and not taking responsibility. So the parents need to take responsibility for what they're doing and what they're going through. And also the children need to take responsibility as well. So everyone should be able to take responsibility for their action and work together as a team, because we're a team. When a family is together, we're a team, right? So it's important to sit down and really talk about the truth of what's going on. So the problem is that it leaves when we're not working as a team and we're blaming each other, it leaves us powerless to solve our problems, because it implies that the only way the problem can be solved is through the other person. That the problem is not about me, it's about you. So you need to solve that, but you need to change. So when we start blaming each other, that's what happens. We're not taking responsibility ourselves. So we need to use constructive words, right? Constructive words when we're talking to our children, when we're talking as a family. That's very important. So, and try that, we should try not to be so defensive, because I know we try to use that, when somebody's pointing a finger at you, what's the first thing we do? We try to be defensive, right? So that's why if we don't use the blaming words and we work as a team, it works really, really well. So another one is, we need to, that negative pattern for behavior. So what we need to do is to be sure to note your anger and behavior, and the behavior of a person that you're in conflict with. So are you angry with your parents that they're divorcing? Are you angry with the other spouse? Whoever you're angry with, we have to remember that, you know, what we do, our behavior and our pattern reflects and it affects everybody else. It affects every single person that's a member of the family. So we need to take responsibility for our own behavior. Okay, so taking responsibility for our own action gives us power back. And part of this is laying out options for how to handle the conflict. Okay, and another one is, let's try a new approach. When, you know, for people say when something's not working, let's try something different, right? Let's try a new approach. Let's, you know, what I would say is that let's do something differently as a family. What will work? What's going to work as a family? What works for one family might not work for another family, right? So the most important thing is to sit as a family, to talk about it, and to discuss how to handle the issue and what's happening. And then once you decide on what approach is best, choose which one is the, you know, it's going to be more effective for the family. So implementing that approach and see how that goes. And review it in a few months. Review it and find out, is this approach working as a family? Is this approach working, you know, as a family? And if it's not, what do we need to change? So this is very important. I know that the last presenter, she did a fantastic job. And she talked about how different culture and how we see and perceive violence in the home. Every culture has a certain way of idea of what divorce is, what violence is, what separation is, and when we talk about mental health, we talk about what is going on when people are going through very devastating time of their life. Because divorce and separation is, and violent is one of the most devastating things in people's life. Till people grow up in their, you know, very old age, and they still talk about the violence that happened to them, or the separation with their parents, or a divorce that happened. So we want to really find out what do we need to do? First of all, we need to talk about it. We need to talk about this. You know, the stigma that happens, that I know some culture, they don't talk about mental health. They don't talk about, you know what, stress. You don't talk about stress. Everybody just keep going, just keep going, keep moving. Or let's not talk about how you feel. It's important that we understand that when you feel a certain way, we can talk about it, that we can name it. Say, if you're stressful, you say, I'm stressful. If you have anxiety, say, I have anxiety. You know, whatever you're feeling is important for you to be able to say it, but say it to whom? Who are you going to say it to? So that's really important. You need to be able to say it to someone that you trust. And that could be anybody that you know that you can really trust. That might be the beginning thing for you, right? And then if you think you need more help, maybe you can reach out to, like, family doctor. If you're comfortable with your family doctor, book an appointment. You want to talk to your family doctor about certain things, like how you're feeling. Or, you know, so I don't know why I feel so, I'm so anxious. I don't know why I feel this way or that way. I don't know why my thoughts are racing. I don't know why I'm having all these different feelings. Talk about it with your family doctor so that you can get help. Counseling. And the family doctor will recommend, they could recommend counseling if you want them to do that for you. They can refer you to a counselor to talk more about this. But I know that some culture don't believe, they don't embrace, the word I want to use, they don't embrace counseling. They don't embrace getting help for things that are what we call mental health. Even the word mental health is a stigma for a lot of people. So it's important that we can, as a family, no matter what's happening, whether, you know, if it's a violence in the family, it's a separation, if it's divorce, it's important as a family that we come together, you know, gather your children, come together and talk about some of these feelings. The more we talk about our feelings, the more we feel comfortable. We don't feel ashamed of it. We don't feel that, you know, you want to know what's happening and what is the thought of the children and everyone that's involved in this process. So the stigma is important, and it's almost like a whole it's a big chapter that I'm not going to talk too much about it because it's a big chapter in our culture and different culture when it comes to mental health and stigma. We need to feel comfortable. You notice that the more people are talking about a topic, the more people come out and talk about it, and the more people come out and talk about it, and then it becomes like, wow, like fire, like everybody's talking about it now. So it's important for us to come out and talk about how we feel and not to be ashamed of it, that, you know, this is going on in my home, you know, and I need help, you know? You go to your family doctor, you know, I need help. I need support. And other people, some people might feel comfortable going to their minister, pastor, reverend, right? Church leader, right? That has that, they're binding when it comes to confidentiality. They can keep your, you know, your information, and they can protect your information. You can go to them and talk to them, you know, and tell them, you know, something's happening in my home. I don't feel comfortable with, I don't have anyone else that I can talk to. I'll be safe. Can I talk to you? So those are some of the suggestions of how we can start, take that first step. I think the first step is always the biggest, hardest thing to do, taking that first step. You know, once you take that first step and speak up, and then, you know, then you can take a little bit more step. Maybe not the family doctor needs to be involved, or maybe a counselor needs to be involved, or maybe, you know, just take that step. And you decide when you say, you know what, I think I got enough support. I think I have enough support. I think I have the pastor is helping me, my doctor is helping me, you know, I'm, you know, different specialists, you know, helping me. And the thing is that as a mental health nurse, it's very important for me to say this, is that through the years of working with individuals that are suffering from mental health, one of the reasons why their mental health got worse is because they never seek for help. They never seek help during the time when they were going through that very difficult time in their life. They didn't have anyone. They didn't know how to go about getting help. And if they just got help and support, counseling, maybe from their doctor, from clergy, from a pastor, whoever it is that they trust, and taking that step, and taking that step will lead to maybe even medication might be part of it. Maybe medication. They might need some medication for anxiety, for anything. If they actually seek those help at that time, it would have reduced the amount of stress or the amount of mental health that they actually have. They will be able to function a lot more better if they actually seek the help early. So early support, early help is important. So I want to challenge everyone today that if you know anyone, because sometimes we even get calls, is a neighbor that sees another neighbor and hear violence going on. And the neighbor will call, you know, and talk to that person and say, you know, I want to encourage you to seek help. So if we see something, we know someone that needs support or someone that needs just a friend, just a listening ear. Maybe we can be that person for that person that's going through that difficult time. And if it's us, I will encourage you to try and seek help and support for whatever you're going through so that you can actually work through it and you can feel healthier and stronger. So I do recommend that CAMH, everybody knows about CAMH, it's a mental health organization in Toronto. It's huge. They have so much resources in there for support. And I encourage everyone to go in there. It's www.camh.ca. To go there, look around, look at the many resources, counseling, lots of different things involved, right? Just to get some ideas of what's going on, just to help you out. And then if you need that help and support, to reach out to someone you trust. And those people that I mentioned could be your pastor, your clergy. It could be, you know, a family doctor, family doctor are very good. A lot of people trust their family doctor. That's why they have their family doctor. And just let them know what you're going through, right? And so I want to challenge everyone that we, as a community, we need to help each other, support each other. And when a family is going through the difficult time that they're going through, whether it's divorce, separation, we need to be there to support each other and to provide resources for each other so that we can actually move together as a community and grow. So that's my presentation for today. Thank you so much. And if you have any questions, let me know.
Thank you so much, Ms. Akirami, for that discussion on mental health, on mental wellness. Thank you for touching on family divorce, not only the impact of it, but also the impact on the family unit, as well as the children. Thank you for sharing the tips, such as trying new approaches. We all know the definition of insanity is trying the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result, right? As well as touching on not playing the blame game and also not blaming yourself for the issue, as well as seeking help as fast as possible when you're aware of the issue instead of partaking in substance abuse. So thank you for that eye-opening conversation. Now it is time for question and answers, and due to the time, we'll only allow for 10 minutes. So if you have any questions, raise your hand or put them within the chat and we'll direct it to whoever the question is for.
Mr. Salami has a question. He has his hand raised.
Oh, yes. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm really impressed about this series, Let's Talk series. First of all, I commend all our guest speakers. Thank you so much, because it's a wide high opener for so many of us, right? Especially when you touch that the topic about family violence and the health issue. I think both of them are just interwoven. Because any product of divorce, marriage, or any mental illness, automatically they act differently, and that's where you see the violence coming in. So, my contribution is more or less of, it's not a question. It's more or less of a contribution to do it, and I really really appreciate both specialists that we brought forward today, and I commend the effort of ACCH, and I implore us all to contribute and make sure that we live in a positive and enabling society, because if you see this. Mental illness, I think it has something to do with the culture. We all come from different backgrounds. And from Nigeria, for example, when we get here, if anything is happening at home, we tend not to want to talk about it. It's like a stigma. How can you say something about your family like that? And people are like very, very, they don't want to talk about so many things. So in my culture, in my language, there's a proverb that said, the answer to madness is when you first talk about it. It's very deep, you know. So many people, they think that when they say something that is wrong with them about their family and stuff like that, they think that they're exposing themselves. In nutshell, they actually like hiding and affecting their life, you know. So it's a very good thing that we are in this environment now. I'm sure that everybody must have experienced this. When we go back home for holiday or vacation and stuff like that, we act differently, we talk differently, because we've acquired some kind of knowledge here, and because of the environment where we are. And then when we go back home and we do things differently, they see us as, oh, what is he doing? So I implore us all, like, being we come from different background, we should try to like live in this society according to how they live in here. So if we have problem, we have to go to respective places to get help. As Mrs. Akirami said earlier, we go to our clergy people, we go to our doctors and all that. So we seek help. And again, when we are engaged in any abusive relationship, violence and stuff like that, we know where to go. So we have lawyers amongst us. We have elderly people. They can, be there and give us adequate advice so that we get help. So thank you very much. That's I know someone's gonna do the vote of thanks, but I just have to contribute this. So thank you so much, everybody. And again, for my friend Romeo, so I already put it in the chat that my next vacation after the pandemic will be St. Vincent. I hope you're gonna be a happy hand. Thank you so much. Thank you.
St. Lucia.
St. Lucia.
Thank you so much for that, Mr. Abisalama.
Short videos, one is 44 seconds, and the other one is just about a minute. I can show them right now. That will even enhance your appetite. One tells you about the similarities between the Caribbean and African continent, and the other one tells you about why you will go there for your next vacation. So with permission of Emmanuel, I can just show those quickly.
Could you please wait after the vote of thanks? That way anyone who wants to see it will still be present.
Stay on. Absolutely.
Awesome. So while we wait for more questions, I actually have some at hand. The first one is actually to you, Mr. Romy Michel. If you have any favorite food, like traditional meal, what would it be? But if not, what meal would you recommend to a visitor in your island?
My recommendation is to try everything.
Everything.
In fact, my wife has a saying, try it once. Okay. Try everything. You've got, there are similar ground provisions. We use, the breadfruit and saltfish. You have different stews. You have, the similarity is there. It may be prepared slightly differently, like you might have more spices and so on. But and when I say spices, I'm not referring to pepper. Okay, when we say spices, we're not referring to pepper. I know some cultures, when they say the food is spicy, they mean that somebody threw a jalapeno into it and chopped it up very fine. No, that's not spicy to us. Spicy is the flavoring. And it's incredible when you get the flavoring in the Caribbean. So my recommendation, if you go there, try it all. There isn't, Barbados, I'll give you an example. Barbados is ackee and salt. Jamaica is ackee and saltfish. Barbados is flying fish and cuckoo. St. Lucia is breadfruit and saltfish. Trinidad is crab and callaloo. I mean, you start going to the different islands and they may have what they call their national dishes, but you get similar things across. I hope that helped.
Yes, thank you so much.
Your appetite is now, in full bloom.
Yes. My next question is for Miss Adams Idore. Why do you think people tend to stay quiet in abusive relationships?
So many reasons. Fear, economic reasons, financial reasons is the biggest one in there. Just dealing with the COVID pandemic, if someone is going through abuse, where are they going to go to? Nobody wants to go to a shelter. There's nowhere is safe. So they remain there. So there is a lack of insecurity if somebody is not economically empowered. And abuse is a mental health issue, meaning a person going through abuse may not really know they're going through abuse because all of the self-esteem over the years of abuse has been deflated. So why the person remains there, it's not a straightforward answer. It's a multi-intersectional issue that engages health, mental health, financial, economic, lack of economic empowerment, as well as lack of self-esteem. It's almost like you're having somebody kill you mentally, psychologically, but you're alive, you're still breathing, but you're dead. And so it's deep-rooted also. And that's why it affects all of us as a community. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And due to the time, that will be all the questions. So Mr. Romeo, you can actually play the video right now, and then we'll move on to the board of thanks. Mr. Romeo.
Yes.
You can play the video now, and then we'll move on to the vote of thanks.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going to do it after the vote of thanks. Okay. Let me do that. And okay.
Mr. Romeo, is there any music attached to the video? Because we can't hear anything.
Okay. Let me stop sharing. Perhaps I did not turn on something. There is music to it. And okay, let me there is actual music. Okay, let me see on the sharing side. When you go to share your screen. Now, there isn't a button that's allowing me to share sound, apparently. Is there something that I'm missing?
I don't think so. Maybe try sharing.
Try sharing again.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, that's the one that the part that the tourists typically don't see. But if you go, if you went to St. Lucia and I'm around, I will make sure that you see that side. The other side is this one. And let me make sure that I'm sharing. Now, this is the site that the tourists typically see.
You can actually talk, Romeo, because we don't have any sound. So you can just give us...
Oh, you don't have any sound? Okay.
No. Tell us what we're saying.
Okay. So what... It is just music in the background. So that's the sulfur springs. It's a dormant volcano. That's a and you can see the type of activities that's available.
So these
if
are
if you're
all,
interested in scuba diving.
So these are all tourist attractions.
You can see similar tropical fruits and so on. Those two mountains are known as the Pitons. It's symbolic for St. Lucia. And that's the sulfur baths. That's what you saw was a typical village street down a particular district. That's the Diamond Falls you saw, and people go cycling into the rainforest. So there are different tours and so on. Many of the villages are fishing villages, so you can see that the fish is actually fresh. When I say fresh, the boat come in and you get it right there.
Thank you so much for those videos.
Yeah, you're absolutely welcome.
So as we come to an end, I'll be passing it on to Mr. Akinkunmi Akinyemi, who is an IT and cybersecurity specialist presently working with Rogers Communications, Inc. He's passionate about a safe and supportive society for Africans and people of Black heritage within and outside of Canada. He is a volunteer with various NGOs and within and outside Canada, and is a member of the digital team at ACCH. And it will give him, and it will be giving us the vote of thanks. Over to you, sir.
All right. Thank you, Emmanuel. Thank you, everyone. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Just to correct that, I'm no more with Rogers Communications, so it's just gonna update my profile. I'm now with the York Regional Police, so I work with the IT team. So a very big thank you to everyone and to our guest speakers. I see myself to be fortunate to be able to join this talk, even though I started to join from my car, because while the meeting was on, I was still on my way from work. We had a shitty day today, like, and heavy eyes was on high tea. So a very big thank you to our guest speakers once again. It was very educative and informative. I learned a lot on my own, and I'm sure everyone else did. So we say a very big thank you to Mr. Romeo Michel for the cultural talk, Mrs. Edusa Adams Hidode for our support in presenting the change in family law, and Mrs. Abiola Akinremi for presenting on mental health and relation to family issues and dynamics. At least, like Mr. Habib Salami has said, as we go back home, we can be able to educate our people back home, letting them know you don't need to keep quiet, like, speak out. Like they say in Yoruba, now it's raining in Nigeria, so it's okay, you know. Yeah, speak out, yeah. So, also, a very big thank you to the ACCH leadership and the organizing teams that took part in every active role, making sure this talk section, you know, came into purpose. Like we say, a very big thank you to everyone and everyone that took time to join this section this evening. We know we all have our busy schedules, but everyone took their time to join this talk section, and we say a very big thank you to you all for joining. And also, we'll also let everyone to know our upcoming events that will be coming up next month, May 2021. That's for diversity and inclusion with MP Adam. So by May 2021, we'll have that section with the MP Adam on diversity and inclusion. So the invite link and how we can join will be sent accordingly when the time comes near. And also in June, remember we had our talk on procurement last month, so we'll have a follow-up by June on procurement, because many people are asking questions and I'm sure many people need more information. So we'll have a follow-up talk by June, and we'll also let everyone to know about the invite link and how you can join. So on that note, I would say thank you to everyone for joining, and we wish everyone a lovely evening and happy weekend ahead, because I can't wait for Friday to come, man. So this is a very busy and shitty week for me today. So thank you for everyone, and thank you for joining. And to our fellow Muslim brothers and sisters, we say Ramadan Mubarak, and may Almighty Allah answers our prayer and accept our fasting. Thank you everyone for joining.
Thank you so much. Bye everyone.
Have a great day, everyone.
Bye-bye. Thank you.